Thanks everyone for coming out. This is a part of the tour from my latest book, A Propaganda System, How Canada's Government, Corporations, Media, and Academia Sell War and Exploitation, which is really a book about information dissemination and suppression in Canadian foreign policy. So my previous books have looked at different policy areas, and this book basically looks at why is it that Canadians overwhelmingly believe this country is a force for good in the world in world affairs, despite a long history of Canada supporting empire, initially the British, more recently the American, and advancing particular Canadian corporate interests abroad. So why are we so confused, essentially, about Canada's place in the world, Canadian foreign policy? And I guess the first question I have for people is, how many people think this book is going to be reviewed by the Winnipeg Free Press, by the Globe and Mail, by the Toronto Star, or others? It's not very likely.
Maybe the Winnipeg Free Press, because they will do more book reviews than any of the others, but it would probably be done badly.
Yeah, I would be very very surprised. I'd be shocked if the Winnipeg Press hasn't been willing to review any of my previous books on Canadian foreign policy. And I have reached out on different occasions. So if they're not willing to review a book critical of Canadian foreign policy, they're probably not willing to review a book that includes their role in messed up Canadian foreign policy.
I
hope too. But you know, there's what we want, and then there's reality. And so that's part of this book is deals with some personal examples of my writing on Canadian foreign policy. I don't discuss it in the book, but my experience with book reviews from dominant media is there's almost no space. Okay, you know, the Toronto Star mentioned the ugly Canadian Stephen Harper's foreign policy. One mention in a broader column about Canadian foreign policy. They mentioned the Canada and Haiti waging war in poor majority in a column. I think the Globe and Mail devoted 20 words, the book section devoted 20 words to the Canada and Haiti book after the 2010 earthquake in Haiti, a book that had been published 5 years earlier. The Halifax Chronicle Herald is the only paper that's reviewed my books seriously on two occasions. The London Free Press, the only time the Canada and Israel Building Apartheid book was reviewed was by the London Free Press. It was a sympathetic professor at Western University. The next week, there was a counter-review. Okay, so a pro-Israel flak organization had an entire counter-review. I'm not familiar with such a thing as a counter-book review, but they apparently do have it when you review books sympathetically that are critical of Canadian foreign policy. The only major paper that has reviewed one of my books is the Montreal Gazette. I live in Montreal. I'd been hassling the Montreal Gazette to review the Black Book of Canadian Foreign Policy a number of years back. And they finally reviewed it after the book got shortlisted for the Quebec Writers Federation Nonfiction Award. They said, okay, fine, we'll review it. This is part of what the review had to say. Quote, readers who haven't spent their formative years having Marxism-Leninism hammered into their heads might find Engler's approach very refreshing. It transported me back to my days as a university student in the Soviet Union to a pre-perestroika class in Marxist-Leninist political economics. So, of course, this was a highly dismissive review. That is for the only time a major paper, I mean, Halifax Chronicle Herald, sort of a major paper, sort of not, has actually taken the effort to review one of my books. My experience writing opinion pieces on Canadian critical of Canadian foreign policy is similar. Over the past 12 years or so, I've submitted dozens and dozens of op-eds critical of different elements of Canadian foreign policy. I believe I've had 4 that were published. Okay? And I know what people are thinking. They're thinking, okay, this guy's a terrible writer. He doesn't know anything. Some people may be eyeing the exit. But in fact, my experience writing on domestic issues is different. So in the early 2000s, as I was getting politicized and starting to write, I submitted maybe about a dozen op-eds to major papers and had about 6 of them published. More recently, a couple years ago, I started working for the Communications Energy Paperworkers Union. One of the things I did was I wrote op-eds on behalf of the union president. Got about a dozen op-eds published. Pretty much every op-ed that was submitted published, all about domestic issues. Yes, it came with the institutional heft of the union, the weight of the union. But there was space, some of them even arguing calling for economic democracy and issues that would be viewed as really pushing the bounds in the dominant media. So what I'm saying is that not that there isn't a bias in the dominant media on domestic issues in favor of the corporate perspective, in favor of elite perspective. There is, of course there is. But that bias is much greater on foreign policy issues. There is an incredibly limited range of debate on Canadian foreign policy issues allowed in the dominant media in this country. My personal experience, I think, is a sign of that. A couple examples of that personal experience. Last year, in the lead up to the launch of the Canada and Africa 300 Years of Aid and Exploitation book in Saskatoon, I submitted an op-ed to the Saskatoon Star Phoenix, about PotashCorp, big company obviously based in Saskatoon, their role in taking the non-renewable resources of the last remaining colony in Africa, Western Sahara, in violation of international law. Okay, I submitted this op-ed to the Star Phoenix editor, who I'd had some interaction with when working for a union. He'd published a couple of our op-eds from the union. His response was to say, quote, "This issue has been on our pages in the past, with both sides of the debate making their points." That's kind of surprised me. So I went and did a search of the Star Phoenix's database on the issue of Western Sahara, PotashCorp, and the Moroccan occupation. I found that there was one letter 2.5 years earlier that was 264 words long about PotashCorp's role in Western Sahara. So for the op-ed editor, that 200 and a rebuttal from the company spokesperson. But from the Star Phoenix editor standpoint, the whole debate had been had. 264 words. We don't need to hear any more about this story. Let's move on to what Kim Kardashian is doing or something like that. Another example, personal recent example of bias in major media, is I blog for the Huffington Post, which, of course, they don't pay writers. They try to offload all the work onto writers. It's now a big multinational, part of a big multinational corporation. But they do have a certain amount of reach, so I do take the time sometimes to submit my pieces to them. And on two occasions, they have refused. I mean, they're unwilling to run, which I deem for political reasons. In fact, I've come to the conclusion that the less interesting article I submit, the higher likelihood they will run it, because it's less sort of controversial. But anyways, but on two occasions, they were very, very crass about the bias on a particular issue. So on two occasions, they refused to mention that Canadian officials cited the responsibility to protect doctrine to justify overthrowing Haiti's elected government in 2004. People familiar with the responsibility to protect doctrine? Most people? Okay, so basically it's a doctrine that says, I think our good friend at this university, is Axworthy still the president of the university?
No.
Oh, he's not? Okay, well, I saw his name walking in some rec center or something like that. But Lloyd Axworthy being one of the people behind the doctrine. But basically, it's a doctrine that says that it's the responsibility of the international community to intervene when there's massive human rights violations to supersede state sovereignty, which, on paper, sounds like a good idea. But in practice, no one's talking about intervening in Washington when Washington's responsible for massive human rights violations somewhere. Basically, it's a tool of the powerful to be used against the weak. And Canadian officials cited it when they justified ousting the elected president in Haiti in 2004. The ambassador, we have the access to information documents that Anthony Fenton got, showing that the ambassador in Port-au-Prince cited it. Also, Minister Denis Paradis, who was then the Minister for La Francophonie and Secretary of State for Latin America in the Liberal government, they also cite it. I put a paragraph in a broader article about Canadian officials citing responsibility to protect doctrine. I linked to the access to information, an article based on an access to information document, linked to an interview with the minister, and the editor at Huffington Post responded by saying, quote, "We need mainstream sources to verify the facts in your blog, and unfortunately, the facts below are only in the publications cited or printed elsewhere by the same authors." So basically, Huffington Post is taking the position that because it has not, it had not appeared in the corporate media, it could not appear in my blog or on their website. That's, of course, a pretty stark example of bias, and makes it very difficult to challenge the dominant narrative about Canada's role in the world. Another example, or Haiti is an extreme example of bias in the dominant media, that I looked into a couple elements of it. Are people here familiar with the Ottawa Initiative on Haiti? Some people heard of the Ottawa Initiative on Haiti? I'm sure some of you have heard about it, or at some point over the years, it's been a few years. Basically, it was a meeting where Canadian government officials brought French government officials, American officials, officials from the Organization of American States to discuss Haiti's future. Haiti's elected government was not invited. At the meeting, as reported on by L'Actualité magazine on March 15, 2003, they discussed that Aristide, the elected president, should be overthrown, Haiti should be put under UN trusteeship, and the Haitian army should be recreated. 13 months later, Aristide is ousted in a Canada-US-France coup. Haiti's been essentially under UN occupation since that time, and the Haitian military has been sort of recreated. So everything that was discussed at the meeting transpires 13 months later. I did a search, a Canadian newsstand search of major dailies for Ottawa Initiative on Haiti, and I could not find a single mention of it by a corporate reporter in this country. There were a few mentions by Haiti solidarity activists in broader articles, but not a single report in a major daily in this country of Canada plotting to oust the elected president of the most impoverished nation in this hemisphere, which then led to thousands of people being killed. But that's, of course, not a story of interest to anyone. Another example of bias in the dominant media is a recent example. The Green Party passed a resolution in favor of boycott, divestment, sanctions targeted at institutions profiting from Israel's occupation. So it's a partial BDS resolution. According to CanadaLand, a media watchdog group, it searched, of a couple dozen, in its words, articles it searched after this resolution was passed. Not a single one of those articles cited a supporter of the resolution that the Green Party convention passed in August. It was passed by the two-thirds majority at the convention and passed by overwhelming majority in an online poll in the lead-up to the convention. But no media outlet considered it worthwhile to cite a supporter of that resolution. They only cited opponents of the resolution, notably within the party, notably Elizabeth May, the head of the party, and also groups outside, like the Israeli ambassador. So it was much more important to cite the Israeli ambassador than it was anyone within the Green Party that actually put forward the resolution. And Dimitri Lascaris, the individual who put forward the resolution, told me, I just did a few events with him, and he was talking about how he did this very extensive interview with a Globe Mail reporter about it. None of it appeared in the paper. Another example of bias around Canadian foreign policy in the dominant media that I looked up, that I cite in the book, and there are many others, is that over the past decade or so, Canada has signed about a dozen foreign investment promotion protection agreements with African governments. Okay, basically what a FIPA, people have probably heard of the China-Canada FIPA, that received a bit of attention. But basically what a FIPA does is it gives multinational corporations, enhances their ability or gives them the ability to sue local governments and international tribunals for lost profit making. Okay? And in the case of the Canada's FIPAs with Africa, with African governments, it's very much about protecting Canadian mining interests across the continent. There's about $30 billion in Canadian mining investment in Africa. Canadian companies dominate in most African countries. And they're involved in significant conflict with local communities, and many different examples of conflict with local communities. Probably the worst example is a Barrick gold mine in Tanzania, where a minimum of 65 people, according to a recent report, have been killed by Barrick-backed security. Some reports say it's as high as over 200 people have been killed in the past decade by mine security. So basically, these FIPAs that the Canadian government is signing with African governments give Canadian companies... Oh, missing a page of my speech. These agreements that Canada has been signing with African governments give Canadian companies the ability to supersede domestic courts to protect their interests, which undermines democracy. They're also undermining democracy because they're locked in for 16 years. Once one government signs them, future governments are beholden to those agreements for 16 years, which, you know, if a new government wanted to change directions. I could not find a single critical mention in a major media outlet of FIPA that Canada has signed with an African government. When the Canadian government signed a FIPA with the government in Burkina Faso in April of 2015, they did so with a government that was an interim government that had taken over after their a popular revolt had ousted the 27-year regime of Blaise Compaoré, who was incredibly pro-mining, pro-Canadian mining. And there was a caretaker government preparing the way for elections. Okay, the Harper government signed a FIPA with that government, with the military officials of that government who were brought to Ottawa, a government that had no pretense of electoral legitimacy, was just supposed to be a caretaker government preparing the way for elections, and that accord is now locks in future governments in Burkina Faso for a decade and a half. This is a crass undermining of the basics of electoral democracy. I wrote an op-ed about the matter, submitted it to four major papers, and of course, none of them viewed this of interest to share with their readers. So my point in telling these different examples of bias in the dominant media is to suggest that it is extreme. There is an extreme bias in favor of power on foreign policy issues within the dominant media in this country. In the book, I go over some of the reasons, some of the structural explanations for this. The most obvious example being who owns the media, right? It's Canadian media is owned by major corporations, among the most concentrated media among wealthy countries. And I cite examples in the book of owners intervening in the newsroom on foreign policy issues. Right? Intervening in the... Do you actually want me to step... Maybe I'll sit back there and you can put this on there.
It's perfect. Stay where you are.
Sure. Mm-hmm. So in the book, I go through the some examples of owners intervening in the newsroom to shape coverage. The most notable example of recent years, of course, is the Aspers. When they bought CanWest in the early, or they set up CanWest in the early 2000s, they intervened to turn those papers to be even more anti-Palestinian than they already were. Another structural explanation is the source of revenue, where media outlets receive their revenue from, which is mostly from advertising, which is largely from major corporations. And in the book, I go through some examples of the interests, the foreign policy interests of some of those advertisers. One example being General Motors, which has been probably the biggest advertiser in Canadian media over the past century. For much of that period, General Motors Defense was also the largest arms manufacturer. So they obviously had interests in a certain type of militarism, a certain type of foreign policy. Also, there is a question of information sources. What institutions have the capacity to produce information on international affairs? The biggest example, the clearest example is, of course, the military, which, as I'll get into more detail later on, is the largest PR operation of any institution in this country. There's also a question of dependence on U.S. wire services. So you find that a lot of international coverage in Canadian papers will come from Associated Press, Washington Post, New York Times, which generally have a pro-U.S. bias. Also, there's the question of media institutions, like other institutions, are responsive to pressure, right? There's a difference between the pressure that you or I might exert by, you know, writing a letter or making a phone call, and the pressure that a wealthy or powerful individual may be able to exert, or even more so, a powerful institution may be able to exert in terms of running a flak campaign against a media outlet. And in the book, I go through a number of examples of pro-military, pro-Israel, and other flak campaigns organized against media outlets that produce information that those groups are not happy with. Also in the book, I go through things like the Canadian Press. Right? The Canadian Press, the major wire agency in the country, was set up during World War I with a major subsidy from the federal government, quite explicitly to bring in more pro-war coverage during World War I. And it really cemented itself as the lead news agency in this country during World War II, where it worked hand in glove with the Canadian military during World War II. There's actually this example where a military public relations official changes hats overnight and becomes a Canadian Press reporter with the same unit. So he's the PR person for that unit, then he becomes a Canadian Press reporter working with the same unit. So basically, they were doing, quite clearly doing military propaganda, pro-war propaganda during World War II. Also in the book, I go through the CBC and some of the, particularly in the early phase of the CBC, for the first couple decades of the CBC, it had incredibly close relations to the foreign affairs establishment. A couple of top military officials on the board of the CBC into the late 50s, early 60s, they were actually, they would pass by reports they were producing by officials within the military to check to see if this was okay to be aired. The book also goes through the history of information control during wars. Extreme information control during wars. During World War I, World War II, and the Korean War, there was censorship. A little bit softer form in the Korean War, but during World War I, there was 253 news outlets in this country that were banned by the censor. The censor was going into record stores and taking records off the shelf that were deemed subversive. The censor was also banning, Canada censor was also banning books, movies that were available in Britain. Right? So Canada was, of course, fighting with the British during World War I, but the censor banned books, and in one case, in one a prominent movie, a very successful movie in England, regarding the war, they forced it to cut about 13% of the movie to be shown in the Canadian context. And the censor's justification for censoring stuff that was available to the British public is, I think, an important justification. He said that because Canadians were distant from the war and unlikely to feel like a direct personal impact from losing the war or the notably from losing the war, that Canadians' commitment to the fight was more based upon idealistic sentiment than it was based upon a direct personal self-interest. Okay, and I think that's a point that's relevant right up until today. Because I think many foreign policy endeavors, wars and others, there's fairly limited direct impact on the bulk of Canadians, right? A bulk of the public, and so controlling what people think about the matter becomes particularly important, making people believe or having people believe that it's a benevolent exercise, that it's a socially useful exercise, becomes that much more important when people have limited a direct self-interest in the matter. The book also goes through some of the different types of information control during different types of wars. Okay, so during bombing campaigns, the Canadian military has tried to really exclude reporters. So recent bombing campaigns, Iraq in the early 90s, former Yugoslavia in the late 90s, Libya, 2011, Iraq, Syria more recently, they have blocked reporters from interviewing the pilots engaged in those bombing campaigns. And they do so, they justify doing so by saying that they're concerned for the family members of the pilots back at home. So like the anti-war movement or others might target family members for their engagement in the bombing campaign. But in fact, the real reason is because it's very difficult to know what's happening from 1,000 feet from the sky. If obviously reporters aren't able to go up there with the pilots, and so you're really much dependent on what the pilots want to say, what the military wants to say about what's actually going on. So they've taken this position around air campaigns, but they take a different position around ground campaigns, most notably in Afghanistan. Right? In Afghanistan, during the war, occupation of Afghanistan, the military tried to basically bring reporters as close as possible, to try to have those reporters see the war from their perspective. And that was, of course, the embedding campaign that most people, I'm sure, are familiar with, which brought reporters onto the base, had reporters come alongside Canadian forces as they pursued their operations. And this is how Scott Taylor, military journalist, described the embedding program in Afghanistan. He said, quote, "What would you say, excuse me, what would you say if the Romanian military occupied your town and a Romanian tank and journalist showed up at your door? You love the government they have installed and want these guys to stay. Of course, the locals are smiling when a reporter shows up with an armored vehicle and an armed patrol." Right? It's not that surprising. But that reality basically never appeared in our papers, in our media, thinking about that or debating that kind of point, never appeared when discussing the embedding program in Afghanistan. So as I mentioned, the military's and the government's strategies of information control during war is not haphazard. Significant efforts are being put into thinking through the different potential strategies, different types of campaign, different types of wars, different types of fighting campaigns will, necessitate different types of information control. So they're spending significant energy. They write about this. They have their own journals that discuss the matters. So there's a lot of energy being put into this. And as I alluded to earlier, the military is the largest PR organization in this country. And part of their PR strategy is to obscure the scope of their PR strategy, right? So we don't actually know exactly how, all the details of their PR strategy, but we know it's pretty darn big. According to Embassy magazine, an Access Information document they got in 2010, the military spent $354 million on PR operations and war commemorations. They devoted 661 staff members. According to another internal document that Embassy acquired, the Department of National Defense says it has, quote, over 13 independent public affairs organizations. So 13 different internal PR departments within the military, the Department of National Defense. Online, you can find contacts for 50 different media relations offices across the country. In 2012, the military monitored 29,519 newspaper articles. They compile reports on what kind of information is being published, also on journalists, what journalists are sympathetic, less sympathetic, who to release information to. They spend $10 to $20 million a year on military recruitment, much of which is just sort of pro-war kind of propaganda, if you like. They spend $10-20+ million on commemorating specific wars. You'll find soldiers at Canada Day festivities, Santa Claus parades, NHL games. I believe they also had a hand in crafting the Winnipeg Jets logo. So they also have sort of like cultural outreach efforts. So it's a massive operation, right? Both at the traditional PR level of working with dominant media, but also at the level of sort of cultural outreach and a sort of more social side to it. But also, the military has a history department, right? They have 50 employees in their history department. Okay, I don't know how big this university's history department is, but I wouldn't be surprised if the military's history department is larger, and maybe even twice as large, two or three times as large, maybe even. And that history department goes back a century to the end of World War I. And in the early years, in the decades after World War I, into the early 60s, most books on Canadian military history were written by official historians of the military. And those books had to go to cabinet. They had to get the defense minister had to sign off on the books. There's actually examples where cabinet discussed parts of books and called for changes of this or that within books being produced by the official historians. Official historians also had significant influence within academia. So into the 1960s, probably most, according to one book, of Canadian academics in the field had worked or had started with the history department, with the military, with the military's history department. The military also has its own university, the Royal Military College of Canada, where the defense minister is chancellor. The military has, as I go through in the book, it has many what I describe as arm's-length organizations, groups like the Royal Canadian Military Institute, the Legion, Conference of Defense Associations, Canadian Global Affairs Institute, Canadian Institute for Strategic Studies. All these groups have, in one way or another, have a dependence on the military, either financial, political, or otherwise. These organizations, oftentimes when you see somebody cited in a quoted in a newspaper article about some military affair, oftentimes they're quoting somebody from one of these arm's-length organizations. Also, many of the op-eds you see in the major papers about different defense matters, it's individuals from these sort of arm's-length organizations that are producing them. And the military has a formal relationship with Canadian universities. So the Security Defense Forum, which was set up in 1967, it funds about a dozen security studies programs at Canadian universities across the country. Not huge amounts of money, usually $100,000 to $200,000. They also have some funds that give to graduate students for conferences and the like. The Security Defense Forum was involved in financing, establishing a number of security studies programs at universities across the country. So the military has massive PR capacities. And it has an important relationship to academia. But it's only one of a number of different sources of private funding or government funding. Foreign policy funding, should I call it, maybe, within Canadian academia. So when you start looking at it, looking at departments in the social sciences, somehow related to international affairs, set up in recent years, an amazing number of them are financed by wealthy individuals, different corporations, or people like the Saudi king. Right, so in 2010, the Saudi king gave $5.3 million to University of Toronto's chair for to create University of Toronto's chair for dialogue among civilizations. Yep. In 2012, Qatar gave McGill's Institute of Islamic Studies $1.25 million. That same year, David Azraeli gave Concordia $5 million to set up the Azraeli Institute of Israel Studies. David Azraeli is somebody who fought with the Haganah in the ethnic cleansing of Palestine in 1947-48. Gerald Steinberg, a noted anti-Palestinian, described Azraeli's donation to Concordia as a, quote, counterattack against pro-Palestinian activism at that university. And I go through many other examples of wealthy individuals funding programs that are tied into in some way associated with Canadian global affairs. The oldest global affairs school in this country, the Norman Patterson School of International Affairs at Carleton in Ottawa, was set up with a major donation, about $4 to $5 million in today's money, from Norman Patterson, who was a senator, a Liberal Party senator, who was very close to Lester Pearson, the lead architect of post-World War II Canadian foreign policy. The initial head of the Norman Patterson School of International Affairs, which is viewed as a sort of a preeminent graduate school in the domain today. The initial head was Norman Robertson. Norman Robertson was a longtime external affairs diplomat. He was on contract with external affairs while he headed up the new Norman Patterson School of International Affairs. And in the book, I detail many different examples of the close ties between the between Foreign Affairs, or now Global Affairs Canada, and the Norman Patterson School of International Affairs. Financial ties, individuals from Foreign Affairs working at the Norman Patterson School. So it continues to have very close ties. The most influential school of global affairs in this country is the Monk School of Global Affairs at the University of Toronto. Are people familiar with Peter Monk? Most people have heard of Peter Monk? Yeah? So Peter Monk's the founder of Barrick Gold, okay? The largest gold mining company in the world. And among 35 million Canadians, there are few individuals that would be less credible as a source of support for a university department on international affairs, okay? He'd be among a couple hundred individuals who really shouldn't be involved in any way in financing or supporting a study of international affairs. Peter Monk has major personal self-interest in this country's foreign policy. His company has benefited from diplomatic support, Canadian aid funds, Export Development Canada funds. His company has lobbied, and he personally has lobbied aggressively against efforts to end public support to Canadian mining companies engaged in major abuses abroad. Peter Monk is also an extreme right-wing ideologue who said that, you know, he told Economist 2 years ago that indigenous people around the world have way too many rights, and it's a big problem, that gang rape is a cultural habit in Papua New Guinea. He's lauded Augusto Pinochet, the dictator in Chile, etc. So he's an extreme right-wing ideologue and has a major self-interest in a particular type of foreign policy. In 97, he gave $6.4 million to U of T, at that point, to set up the Monk Center for International Studies. As part of his initial contract with the U of T, the university had to receive advice, the center, new center had to receive advice from Barrick Gold's International Advisory Board, which included Brian Mulroney, George Bush Sr. So, you know, certain type of advice you would get. He made his contract, or he made his funding, not all up front. So it was given out in installments, meaning that if he wasn't happy with the direction of the center, he could withdraw his funding. So he maintained leverage, financial leverage, over the center. He was happy with things. He added another $5 million in 2006. And then in 2010, he added $35 million to set up the Monk School of Global Affairs. As part of the contract to set up the Monk School of Global Affairs, he had it so the U of T committed $39 million from its endowment. He also got the Ontario and the federal government to kick in another $50 million combined. And he receives a tax write-off of about $16 million for his $35 million donation. So effectively, he's putting in about $19 million to mobilize about $100 million, mostly of public funds, for a school that he has had and has influence over. And that school has shown itself to be establishment in its thinking and its operations. So, for instance, the Monk School participated in the Harper government's low-level war against Iran. Right? They received $250,000 in 2012 to engage in what was quite explicitly a regime change operation in Iran. This is a public university, an academic, supposedly academic department, engaging in a quite explicitly a regime change effort in Iran. Also, the Monk School has been involved in efforts to undermine those campaigning for ending public support to Canadian mining companies engaged in abuses abroad. And I should note that the Monk School is incredibly influential, partly because it's has a whole lot of resources, but also because it's in the media capital of the country, right? It's downtown Toronto. And notably with the Globe and Mail, the former editor-in-chief of the Globe and Mail stepped down about a year ago. He immediately had a position with the Monk School, like days later. He joined another previous editor-in-chief of the Globe and Mail, who's also at the Monk School. And the Monk School has a formal relationship with on a journalism program with the Globe and Mail. Another domain of international affairs in Canadian universities that is influenced by government departments is the international development studies programs. Okay, so international development studies programs began in the late 60s, early 70s, and have greatly expanded in recent years, in large part with funding and support from CEDA, from the Canadian International Development Agency. Okay, CEDA, most of the individuals who set up initial programs had gone on CEDA projects abroad, and CEDA directly financed the beginning of different programs. Between 1986 and 2006, CEDA provided $250 million to universities. If you go on McGill's International Development Studies program, you'll find listed contracts of over $1 million from CEDA, IDRC, International Development Research Center, which is another aid arm of the Canadian government, and foreign affairs. And I should mention that CEDA, while maybe its outlook on world affairs is a little bit better than the military, it is still an arm of Canadian foreign policy. Okay, it's not in the business of funding criticism of Canadian foreign policy. Not to say that there isn't some individuals working on CEDA-funded projects that don't, you know, challenge different elements of Canadian foreign policy, but at a big picture level, this is an institution that's an arm of Canadian foreign policy. And in their work with Canadian universities, they have pushed back against universities' attempts to have more control over that funding. So CEDA's always pushed to maintain its power and control over funding to universities, I think, for quite obvious political reasons. So even international development studies, which is viewed as a little bit more of a sort of liberalish kind of area, there's all kinds of dependence on arm of Canadian foreign policy for their funding. So if you pick up the major journal, right, the Canadian Journal of Development Studies, I believe it's called, they state openly that they receive funds from CEDA, from IDRC. The book goes through a number of the arm's length organizations that have been sort of spawned from CEDA or foreign affairs. Groups like the North-South Institute, set up in the mid-70s, quite explicitly about by CEDA funding, because CEDA wanted a body that would be lobbying for increased Canadian aid budget. So it was sort of institutional prerogative, and I'm not going to get into it in detail and get into it afterwards. Canadian aid is not what most people perceive as Canadian aid as, like, you know, benevolence. It's largely been a geopolitical tool, but I won't get into that in any detail. Other groups like Rights and Democracy, Canadian Institute of International Peace and Security. Both of those groups were set up by Acts of Parliament. They're no longer in existence, but they were around for decades, heavily engaged in foreign policy affairs. They were set up by Acts of Parliament, received all their funding from the federal government, and when the federal government was no longer happy with their political direction, it was easy to just chop the budget and they disappear basically overnight. CEDA spends tens of millions of dollars on what it describes as promotion of development awareness. So between 2005 and 2008, CEDA spent $47.5 million in promotion of development awareness. Over $3.5 million of this money went to fund projects where Canadian journalists would go abroad and cover Canadian aid projects. Okay, so, these are mainstream journalists. These are people publishing in, you know, global television, CTV, Ottawa Citizen. There was a recent example that I wrote about in the Ottawa Citizen about 2 months ago, where an Ottawa Citizen, they did a big front page Saturday story on Canada's role in creating the Ebola vaccine. The story said openly, Ottawa Citizen said openly that The journalists' ability to travel to West Africa was because the IDRC, the International Development Research Center, which is a crown corporation, arm of Canadian Foreign Policy Aid, had funded it. Okay, so this is a laudatory story of Canada's role in the Ebola vaccine. And let's just say that the IDRC and CETA are not in the business of funding Canadian journalists to go cover a mine that a Canadian company is operating in Ecuador that has destroyed a local community's ecosystem or the like. They obviously fund projects that are that portray them positively. But it's amazing that the Ottawa Citizen would not see any conflict of interest in taking funding from an arm of Canadian foreign policy to report on a project of Canadian foreign policy. During the war in Afghanistan, Le Devoir newspaper had an agreement with CETA to, quote, remind readers of the central role that Afghanistan plays in CETA's international assistance program. Right? Part of the propaganda exercise during the occupation of Afghanistan was to talk about all the, you know, schools that Canada was paying to build and all the girls that were now going to school. But they also, alongside that, they had efforts to have journalists cover those schools or those endeavors that Canadian aid was apparently developing. Moving towards a conclusion, one rule of Canadian foreign policy or ideas in Canadian foreign policy that you won't hear in many places is that the more impoverished a nation, the greater the gap is likely to be between what Canadian officials say and do. Okay? So basically, the weaker, more impoverished a place, the bigger the lies Canadian officials can tell us about what they're doing. And the main explanation for that is because power, to a large extent, defines reality. Right? And there's no better example of that than Canada's role in Haiti in the mid-2000s. So you have the Canadian government involved in plotting to overthrow an elected government, executing the coup, supporting a post-coup dictatorship that is responsible for thousands of people being killed, responsible for thousands and thousands of different human rights violations. The Lancet British Medical Journal said there was 35,000 rapes in the Port-au-Prince area in the 22 months after the coup. So a major deterioration of human rights in Haiti at the time. And the Canadian aid was involved, and the officials in the coup government were employees of CETA. Top officials in the coup government were employees of CETA and employees of USAID. The police force that was committing many of the human rights violations, going into the slum neighborhoods and repressing the pro-Aristide, pro-democracy neighborhoods that was firing over and over again on peaceful demonstrations demanding return of the constitutional government, that was all being funded by our aid money. It was our police that were training the force. This was our benevolence to Haiti, right? What Canadian officials were telling us was our aid was basically going to supporting the torturers of the majority poor in Haiti. And so how's that possible? How is it possible that the gap between reality and perception gets so big? On one hand, Canadians being told this is our benevolence, our aid, and reality being this is, you know, further impoverishing and I guess immiserating an already impoverished and impoverished people. And again, the main reason is because what capacity do the slum dwellers in Port-au-Prince and others that were the primary victims of Canada's coup, what capacity do they have to tell their story to Canadians versus what capacity does Ottawa, Washington, Paris, the Haitian elite that worked with the three foreign powers have to tell their story about what was going on? It's the gap in resources and capacities is massive. Just to give you one example is that at the Aristide government, Its budget, the national budget in Haiti, just before the coup, was $300 million U.S. for the whole nation's budget. Right, this is a country that's heavily centralized in its administration. The Canadian military's PR budget alone was equivalent to the entire national budget of the Haitian government. So, of course, the Canadian military, U.S. military, other forces have a great deal more capacities to tell their story than those victimized by those policies. So it's my sense, my view, that the bias in the dominant media in this country on Canadian foreign policy is worse than most people who are even critical of the media think. Right? When you start knowing about some of the particular foreign policy issues and have a little bit of background on what's going on, you start realizing the bias. And of course, it's difficult to know that much about that many international issues, but I think the broad bias generalizes. And so it is bad. Sometimes it's hard to get your head around how bad the bias is. But it isn't a totally enclosed system that we're operating in. Yes, there's all kinds of influences that wealthy individuals and others have at universities in favor of a certain type of outlook, but we are able to have this meeting, right? We're able to have a meeting criticizing some of these issues. We're also not in a totalitarian system, so you know, none of us will be particularly targeted after the meeting or anything like that. Even within major media outlets, while there is important structural biases in favor of power, it's not a complete system. It's not completely enclosed. And I have some experience with that I detail in the book with Montreal Gazette around the time of the coup in Haiti, and specifically a reporter, Sue Montgomery, who's a sort of a somewhat progressive reporter usually. She was the person that the paper sent down to Haiti in the days before what becomes the foreign-backed coup in the country. And she knew nothing about Haitian affairs at the time, and she was basically completely played by Canadian officials and by organizations that are sort of arm's-length Canadian organizations in Haiti. She got robbed, and the Canadian ambassador told her that the people responsible for robbing her were the Chimère, who were purported pro-Aristide thugs. The Canadian ambassador also told her that Aristide had told the Chimère to target international journalists because he wasn't happy with the coverage, and he told her to tell other journalists at the Hotel Montana, where most international journalists stay, that Aristide's thugs were targeting international journalists. She did it. She believed it. She told other journalists, and she retells the story in a very good master's thesis by Isabel MacDonald that goes over that interviews many of the Canadian reporters that were sent down to cover the coup period, including people like Neil MacDonald of the CBC, and who reveal just how much their whole perspective on Haitian affairs comes out of the Canadian embassy and other organizations tied to Canadian foreign policy. But in the case of Sue Montgomery, so she does all kinds of terrible coverage around the time of the coup and a bit after. But over the next 2 years, she does a 180-degree turn on the issue, whereby early 2006, when the federal election happens here, she actually she publishes a column saying that Pierre Pettigrew, who was then the foreign minister, and Denis Coderre, who was a special representative on Haiti, that they should lose their seats for their role in undermining Haitian democracy. So she goes from totally puppeting the Canadian government perspective to saying that top officials, Canadian government, should lose their seats for what they had done in Haiti. And the explanation for her shift is multifaceted, my sense. One is that with time, as she got some distance from being in Haiti, she realized that the stories that were being told to her by Canadian officials didn't make sense. But another part of her changing positions is the work of Haiti Action Montreal. Right? We publicly criticized her, aggressively criticized her, which she didn't like, and we sent it to her. We also simultaneously organized other events where we brought up speakers from Haiti, brought people who had a different perspective on Haiti, and quite frankly, it was a much more compelling explanation of what was taking place. And we invited her to come and other journalists. We also campaigned more generally. You know, we organized many demonstrations. We put up tens of thousands of Canada Out of Haiti stickers all across downtown Montreal. And so we mobilized. And she changed her perspective. And because she became a sort of in-house expert on Haiti, that had an impact on the rest of the paper. We were able to develop some openings within the Montreal Gazette more generally on the issue of Canada's role in Haiti. Obviously, they didn't come close to detailing what they should have in terms of the horror of what Canada was involved in Haiti, but they did. We did open up some important avenues that clearly embarrassed the Canadian government and Canadian foreign policy. So the main or a central explanation for why the bias is so much worse on foreign policy issues than on domestic issues is that there is no countervailing force on foreign issues. On domestic issues, there is somewhat of a countervailing force to the corporate perspective, most notably at an institutional level, labor unions. With all the problems that labor unions have, they are somewhat of a countervailing force to the dominance of the corporate perspective on domestic issues. And that force doesn't exist on international affairs. So if we want to equilibrate, should I say, I'm not pronouncing that word properly, if we want to even things out between the massive military PR budget, the foreign affairs budget, the CETA, all the arms of Canadian foreign policy, their role in information dissemination, and other powerful institutions, we need to get mobilized. And there's many facets to that. One thing that I want to plug at this part of building towards establishing this tour is something called the Canadian Foreign Policy Institute. There's a sign-up sheets at the back there. And basically, it's about setting up a left-wing foreign policy think tank in this country, initially basically just a hub of critical ideas on Canadian foreign policy, just a website hub. There's many, you know, the ambitions are significant with time, obviously the possibility of setting up chapters across the country, you know, producing reports, having speakers, banks of people who are sort of experts, if you like, in different fields. But beginning small, which is a hub, a place for critical information of Canadian foreign policy, that actually doesn't exist in a country of 35 million people that doesn't currently exist. But whether it be a left-wing foreign policy think tank, whether it be the peace movement and restarting the peace movement that is largely dormant in this country right now, whether it be international solidarity organizations engaged in mining justice solidarity, whether it be building up media outlets that aren't just sycophants of power, we need to build a countervailing force to the dominant foreign policy institutions, and I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much.